campaigner called Liberating the NHS. Various parodies of that have come forward, eviscerating the NHS, privatising the NHS, etc. It revolves around the 80 billion of the NHS budget in England. A growing share of this 80 billion would be opened up to a variety of private providers to come along and bid for various bits of work within the 80 billion and expand their operations at the expense, clearly, of the existing NHS services. The primary care trusts, there's about 150 of them, they would all be scrapped. And the reality is the GPs won't have the time, won't have the inclination, won't have the knowledge to do this job, and will know it, and will buy in that support from somewhere else. They'll either re-recruit the people being made redundant out of the PCTs, so you pay them a redundancy fee and then you re-recruit them, probably on different terms and conditions, possibly higher terms and conditions, certainly outside of the accountability structure of a PCT, but in the wings we have a whole bunch of private companies want to offer these services. Why recruit PCT managers who know something about the NHS when you could recruit United Health or McKinsey's or somebody who know nothing about the NHS but appear to be very, very well-spoken and briefcase-carrying Americans with an interest in making a lot of money? And United Health are already picking up contracts. In West London, all the GPs in Hounslow have joined one consortium, the Great West Consortium, which is a Pathfinder consortium. And they've recruited United Health, the second largest health insurer in the United States, to run what they call a referral management service. And this referral management service has a target of saving money from the consortium. What does referral management mean? It means every person who's referred to hospital treatment by a GP in Hounslow, that doesn't go to the hospital at all, it goes to United Health, some bureaucrat from United Health, a private profit-seeking company. Some bureaucrat from there will sit down and look at this referral and judge whether or not it should go ahead or not, or whether it should be sent back to the GP and they should be referred to some alternative type of treatment. And they tell you it's patient choice, it's United Health's choice, it's the referral manager's choice. And if you look at the bill, it's staggering because there's actually no prescribed shape or size for a consortium. And they're not required to meet in public, they're not required to consult the public over the changes that they're proposing. GP consortia are only responsible for the population covered by the practices in the consortium. So if you take GPs in central London, for example, they're only responsible for their immediate practice caseloads. Okay, well, what about all the commuter traffic and the tourists and the various other people coming in and out of London, millions of them every day? Who's responsible for ensuring there's enough hospital capacity and other capacity to deal with the emergencies and issues that might arise from that? It's completely left up in the air. Basically, there will be no status for an NHS trust after 2013. The provision of services will be opened up to any willing provider. This is the question, who isn't any willing provider? Any willing provider, Delboy and Rodney, with the legendary Trotters International Traders van, the three-wheeler, who are any willing providers. We remember what happened in the 1980s when hospital cleaning was put out to contract and a whole bunch of companies were set up specifically to undercut the costs that were currently prevailed in the health service. Cleaning was privatised, cleaning standards were smashed to smithereens. We had the heyday of MRSA started its long and inglorious rise. We had the hospital cleaning staff, which were part of the hospital team, were smashed up. That work was effectively casualised. And 30 years later, we're still facing the consequence of that type of price competition. The lowest price bid will tend to win, because bear in mind, all of these changes are taking place in the context of £20 billion target for savings by 2014. 20 billion, 4% a year cost reductions to be imposed on the NHS. They'll be looking for any way possible of finding cheaper services. And yet again, it's clear that GPs are not going to have control over this, because GPs won't be deciding which providers are suitable and which aren't. There will be a central register will be drawn up by Monitor. Once a company is on that, they can offer their services anywhere they choose, and GPs will be required to offer patients the choice of those any willing providers. In other words, not just the local existing hospital services, but any other company that's then added to the list in their area. under European Union competition law, if GPs locally, consortia locally, decide to actually give any kind of preference at all to services set up under the NHS rather than to these new private providers, they can complain to monitor, to the regulator, who can step in, and the brief of monitor is to maximise competition amongst providers in this new health market. So this really means business. This has got real teeth. They're not able, under competition law, to collaborate with their hospital colleagues in the same area because they're in different organisations, and that's collusion under competition law and can be actually complained about by private companies that think they're being unfairly walled out of a link-up between doctors and one section of the providing community, so-called. You see, you're dividing medics and you're potentially getting contradictory decisions between one GP consortium and the next. If they choose to use other services, money will flow out of the existing NHS services and those services will be forced to close. And of course, all of this reliance on price competition is despite all of the evidence and all of the advice from anyone that knows anything about it, which is that in healthcare at least, price competition undermines quality. Price competition on a vegetable market might mean you get a cheaper cauliflower. And it might mean that when you get one of your cheap cauliflowers ham, occasionally you find that the middle of that cauliflower is rotten. And what have you lost? You've lost a couple of, 20 pence or whatever it is that you spend on the cauliflower, and nobody's going to die as a consequence. You choose wrongly in a health market, you choose poor quality care in a health market, it can make a serious long-term difference to your health, your well-being, and possibly even to your life. Andrew Lansley says, it's not ideologically driven, of course. Okay, but one of the fundamental strengths of the National Health Service when it was set up was that it gave the opportunity for central government and then for local bodies increasingly to actually allocate resources according to need and preferentially invest in areas where there was a greater social need. All of that will be dissipated and effectively ended under a market system. I think it's important, therefore, to recognise the context of all this. The 20 billion of cuts. Stephen Dorrell, right, a Tory a chair of the Commons Health Committee, even he has pointed out that not only is this level of cuts year on year never been achieved in Britain, it's never been achieved anywhere in the world. 4% year on year actual reduction in costs or efficiency savings or, this is cuts, actually, because when you look around at what's being done to save this money, the classic case is South West Essex. In South West Essex, they have now got a list of 213 different treatments and operations that you can't get anymore on the NHS. It went up by 114 in order to make the latest round of savings. So there's a whole list of things, which include hip operations and knee operations, which are going to be actually cut off the list. You can't get them in South West Essex anymore, not available on the NHS. You know, that's one way of saving money, I suppose, just reduce the number of things you're prepared to pay for. Well, sorry, it might be a very common condition, but we don't do that here. You might have to think about going private or going without. That's a patient choice. It's not the kind of choice that most of us, I think, had in mind when we were offered more choice by Andrew Lansley.